Kia ora everybody, and thanks for attending this. This presentation aims to have a scattered approach across all sorts of considerations, and I'm hoping to be able to cover both government and commercial interests here today. I'm happy to take any questions and feedback through Twitter or through my email as well. So I guess a lot of people are going to say, well, why bother, why consider multicultural issues with digital? I mean, some people will think it's quite irrelevant, but it's definitely entwined through the Treaty of Waitangi in terms of partnerships and of taonga. The United Nations Declarations of Rights of Indigenous Peoples has numerous sections which directly relate to Indigenous and Māori ethics with digital. It's my belief that the New Zealand Human Rights Act and the New Zealand Bill of Rights Act cover it as well, though I'm not confident that it would be enforceable in New Zealand at the moment. And it's also important that, I mean, New Zealand, we are way ahead of other Indigenous peoples in the world in terms of recognising Indigenous rights with digital and just having access into Indigenous areas. And also, some people say, well, look, you know, Māori didn't have cameras and internet and computers and they didn't even write stuff down, so how's all this applicable? But, you know, traditionally, Māori and all Indigenous peoples, we did have a form of writing, and it was carvings, it was paintings, it was artwork, and stories were handed down from generation to generation. In terms of photos and videos, we have a lot of traditions about reflections on water and reflections on polished stone. We have stories about shadows, which all represent modern-day images and videos. It's also important to consider that Māori, statistically, we're Māori are underrepresented in ICT, and therefore we don't really have a voice. My grandparents' generation and some of my parents' generation look at ICT and digital and say, no, look, it's not for us, just, you know, it's just leave it, ignore it. So therefore, trying to discuss Māori cultural ethics, it hasn't really come to light yet. I expect that it's going to come to light in a big way very soon. We've got whole generations of children who have been brought up through Kohanga Reo, the Māori preschool, who have also gone through full immersion Māori schools, Kura Kaupapa Māori. And these children are going to come to the workforce, and they're not going to ask, you know, they're not going to ask, well, where's the cultural appropriate way of doing this, or where's the representation? They're just going to demand it because they don't know anything different. We also, from an iwi perspective, we know that we need to change our corporations to also adjust to that kohanga reo movement of children and that generation. Also, the way that we use the internet, it actually intertwines and uses Māori genealogy. So we have genealogy links to the air, the water, earth, and space. So the way I see it is everything we use for the internet and for digital, basically piggybacks on our Māori genealogy. And I think it's important to also consider that New Zealand society is rapidly changing. It's been estimated that Polynesian Māori will be much larger than it is now, and also that we'll likely have an Asian population which is larger than both European and Māori. I added this slide last night after listening to a presentation yesterday. So for any contractors who want to work with Māori and iwi organisations, it's quite important to first of all learn how to pronounce words properly. If you mispronounce an iwi name or a person's name, it's quite likely you're not going to have a contract with the iwi, with the iwi group. So yesterday I listened to a really awesome presentation, and I was fixated on the presentation, liked the person presenting, but then he used an analogy with our New Zealand's Victoria Cross winner, Willie Apiata. Used the terminology about Willie Apiata would come in all guns blazing. Unfortunately, Willie Apiata's name was pronounced Willie Apiata, and I stuck on the mispronunciation, and I couldn't finish listening to the rest of the presentation. It wasn't until later on where the rest of the presentation processed in my head. And I also know from a fact, from personal experience, that I've been on a decision-making group, and we've had contractors come in who couldn't pronounce my name, couldn't pronounce other Māori words. And although they were on paper the best company or the best contractor, they weren't awarded the contract because of that mispronunciation. Māori and iwi organisations typically look for long-term relationships instead of just a casual do a job and leave type thing. It might seem strange to some people, but if you are with an iwi organisation and everyone's referring to a person as auntie or uncle, it'd be respectful just to follow and call that person auntie and uncle as well. And it's also important to consider that iwi money, it isn't just iwi from, iwi on a gravy train cashing in, and there's intergenerational money that needs to be used for many years to come. And so iwi are quite cautious about how they spend their money. So getting to work with Māori and iwi organisations requires a bit of getting to know the social structure of Māori society. So it's important to know that every region in the country has what we call mana whenua. They're the iwi that reside in that area. So in Wellington, one of the mana whenua is Te Ati Awa. So I think most people know what iwi is. Now, iwi have sub-clans or sub-tribes called hapu. And a hapu is made up of individual families who are then made up from individuals. A kaumātua is an elder who has a lot of respect, but not every old person's a kaumātua. We also have runanga, which is a tribal council. And the tribal councils usually reside on a marae. So it's important to realise that not all Māori are brought up Māori. We've had, since 1840, New Zealand government has successfully introduced legislation that's assimilated culture. We've had native schools. We've only just recently managed to have the Māori Language Act recognised. A lot of Māori have adapted to various religions, ignoring traditional cultural values. And it's also important to realise that just because your colleague or someone you know speaks Māori, it doesn't mean that they know about Māori culture. Anyone can learn to speak Māori from a book. Learning about culture, you need to live it and breathe it. And just recently in New Mexico, I heard a story about why it's important not to assume. I'm not sure if you can see the pictograph on the rock up there, but archaeologists just went and asked a member of the Pueblo clan, oh, what does this rock mean? And the person didn't actually have the tribal authority or the knowledge. So he goes, oh, that's the sun god. So the history books and the documentation put this pictograph as being a sun god. When, in fact, the people with the actual knowledge said, no, this is not a sun god. This is a symbol for the land. You can't work the land. If you try and work the land, it's going to be swallowed up by the river. Crops don't grow. So this is a warning sign. the same thing happens with Māori culture as well. People often assume that there's a brown face in the office, or, you know, white face, whatever. You know, that person must know everything about being Māori, and that's where mistakes are made. Indigenous data sovereignty is a new international theme coming through now. Basically, it's the ability for Indigenous people to access and take control of their own data. Traditionally, governments and researchers have had more access to tribal data than iwi and tribes have themselves. There's a growing appetite by iwi to have access to their own data to help out with social issues, do financial predictions. And iwi and Māori data needs to be treated with caution and sensitivities, much like you would with government data or your client's financial data. Māori data shouldn't just be put in the cloud with disregard to who actually owns the data. Another area which is emerging now is digital colonialism, which is basically just taking data and information and digitising it without permission or without consultation. Some people argue, well, information's in a book, I can digitise it because the author's already given permission for it to be published. The flip side to that is, quite often that information was provided historically to ethnographers on the basis that it would stay in a book. It wouldn't be accessible to anyone, anywhere. And typically, there was a number of restrictions. You wouldn't expect a book. You'd expect a book to have restrictions compared to something digital where you can manipulate it and do anything else that you want with it. So authentication is unique. I think it's unique for Māori. Typically, Māori don't have landlines, and they'll have a mobile phone. But quite often, that mobile phone is a communal phone. It's shared amongst, you know, a family, or it's shared amongst a group of people. Usually on prepaid plans, and using data is usually on the free Wi-Fi at the library or the telecom phone boxes. Use of computers in the homes is statistically, Māori don't usually have computers in their homes, so it creates extra considerations for security. And then authentication questions such as, what is your grandmother's surname or other family-related names? It becomes kind of a waste of time for Māori, because typically Māori know everyone's family. Everyone at the local marae, I know everyone's grandmother's maiden names, their surnames, their first husband, second husband. It's all public knowledge. So trying to come up with an authentication based on genealogy and personal names doesn't really work too well for Māori. So using naming conventions it's nice to see Māori names being used, but sometimes it can be offensive. If in doubt, I say consult. Use of personal names and God names can create a whole new issues. Examples, someone may have called their firewall Tumatuenga, the God of War, which has its own issues for various people, and depending on where your company is placed. Some people like to try and use Māori place names for different things on their networks. And again, I say just be cautious. There's some names have hidden meanings, which could actually be quite contrary to what you're trying to do. Again, even popular Māori names can be offensive. I'm sure that everybody in the room's heard of the haka kamati. That haka is extremely offensive to any South Island Māori because it was created by a man who basically assimilated or tried to exterminate the majority of the Ngāi Tahu tribe. But through media and through the All Blacks, it's become a household name. Keeping a consistent theme with names in your network can be really effective and quite cool. But again, just make sure that you consult. Shortening names because of spaces can end up having the quite detrimental effects. So having a really nice, respectful name can end up being a derogatory term quite easily just by missing off part of the word. So staff photos, I think most organisations have staff photos. So it's an area of sacredness for Māoridom. So if you're going to have staff photos, some caution about how they're stored should be considered. As if a staff member dies, it's like bad luck for Māoridom to have photos of the living and photos of the dead next to each other or in the same area. So whether there's a policy to have those photos moved or there's some policy in place. Some, not so much my generation, but older generation of people kind of having photos in different places with other people can be a sensitive issue for them as well. So, it would just take some consideration on how you do that. And of course, putting photos of staff members on the internet, some organisations just take it for granted, but for Māoridom, it can be a sensitive issue. With the fact that every time you have your photo taken in Māoridom, there's a belief that it's taken away part of your inner self, your spirit, so to speak. And then by putting that photo on the internet, it's opening up the floodgates to abuse and losing one's mana and their spirituality. DNA has been in the media a lot lately. There seems to be this big push for people to go get DNA tested to find out where they come from and who they are. In Māoridom, DNA isn't owned by the individual. It's owned by the wider iwi, or the wider tribe. And it's not, so it's because the DNA is the iwi. Eye retina scans are the same. It's a sacred part of the body, and it's also some of our beliefs say that the eyes are the look into your inner self, so it's also quite sacred. In my opinion, there's absolutely nothing, there's no cultural sensitivities at all with voice recognition or fingerprints. There are two things that are really quite safe. Now, a tā moko is the tattoo across a person's face of the traditional Māori tattoos, and the moko kauai is the female version just on the chin. Now, I think it was last year that there was a DEFCON meeting, which I didn't attend, but I got an email from a colleague saying, someone from DEFCON's just tweeted this photo with an old lady with a moko kauai talking about facial recognition. There was a number of issues with that photo. I was in a meeting at the time, and the person I was sitting next to, it was his mother, and she hadn't given permission for that photo to be used. And it was, thankfully, the person who did tweet it was quite respectful and deleted the photo as soon as he realised it was offensive. But the moko kauai and the moko is a person's genealogy, it's their life history. So instead of having a photo album, the person has the moko kauai. So by taking photos and storing and using the moko kauai and the tā moko for facial recognition, I deem it to be the digital equivalent of the old trade of shrunken heads and human skin as art. It's offensive, and it's also just because someone with a moko kauai has a photo on the internet doesn't give you the permission to go and take the moko kauai or the tamaku off their face and use it for other things. Unfortunately, tami iti has become a victim of that numerous times, where people think it's acceptable to manipulate and do whatever. But I mean, I'd say it's not acceptable for me to take your family photo album, take pictures out and manipulate the pictures to for my own good, and just the same way as it is with the tāmoko and moko kauai. So software licenses, when it comes to iwi knowledge and iwi data, there should be some consideration with the licenses. Where possible, with software licenses should be open source or open data related, so that they can respect traditional knowledge and Indigenous data sovereignty. I realise that it's not always possible, but if you're working with an iwi organisation or a Māori organisation, it might be worth just pointing out what a Microsoft licence does with your information compared to what an open licence can do. And explain how the knowledge can actually, how the knowledge gets encrypted and changed around, and how that information, how the data becomes proprietary to the proprietary software as opposed to open. Iwi organisations and Māori organisations would likely go for the open option, even though that may cost more money or present other issues. Passwords and usernames in organisations is common, as we know. There's the link up here, uses Diceware. It's an authoritative list of Māori words which can be used for password generation. But I just urge caution that Māori names and god names, place names it could be deemed a little bit offensive if you're using, chopping and changing them for passphrases. But at the same time, it's also the most, it'd be the hardest sort of password to crack, because, well, the hardest Māori word to try and guess, because personal names and god names don't appear in any publications per se. The policies of using people's usernames, time and time again, I've seen a person's name being shortened, so like last name dot first initial, vice versa, and it creates a Māori word which is like offensive, or it's laughable, or it's kind of not cool. So I think if there could be some sort of consideration in policies for that. Common example, I look at the Silver Ferns. There's a player there. If you used initial the first name dot last name, it would end up calling that person like a SHIT head, translated to Māori. So it's quite common, and it can be quite upsetting for those people. And another consideration as well is that a lot of personal names have macrons in them. And if you don't put the macron in a name, then it changes the whole, it's not the person's name anymore. So some sort of consideration for macrons and names as well is important. So for people who speak Māori, I've noticed an increase in the last year or so with targeted phishing scams, malware being sent from people using Google Translate to try and send emails. Unfortunately, it's coming more and more common, but the only protection at the moment is the Google Translate doesn't translate Māori properly, and it just, a lot of the emails that come through don't make sense, and you can tell. But Māori-speaking communities, I believe, could become quite vulnerable if the wider community doesn't understand that this is happening now. And it doesn't take too much to, it would be quite convincing to get an email from a colleague who does speak Māori saying, oh, you know, bro, here's a picture from whatever, and it would be quite difficult to, yeah, to tell whether it was phishing or not. There's a number of social issues with digital security. Basically, there's no, I mean, NetSafe does an awesome job. I mean, just they're just really awesome. But there's nothing there that's specific to Māori language speakers, to marae, to that whole generation of kohanga reo kids who are coming through. There's nothing specific there. There's also an inherited lack of trust and caution with authorities and with people in power. So from what I've witnessed, people who do become victims of cyber attacks or malware, et cetera, they're not likely to go and talk to anyone. They'll talk amongst themselves in their own family units. So there needs to be some kind of consideration for that as well. And just finally, so I see there's a number of future risks to do with information and with security. I had an interview with a person who said to me that cyber activism is just taking traditional street protests and taking it to the internet, which I think is a bit of a worry. But I think if the security community is aware that there's thinking like that out there, I mean, maybe you guys can do something. I'm not sure. There's a general fear of Internet of Things. There's a fear that if you have a fridge that tells you you're going low on milk or you need to top up on something else, that social services can then also monitor your family in ways that they've never been able to monitor up until now. And basically, just play on those negative stats that Māori always seem to predominantly feature in. There's also the cultural effects of having information inside your food. So food traditionally needs to be kept separate from work. It needs to be in its own place. So if you've got digital waves going through there and information, and it could be culturally offensive to many people. I guess that marae won't like that sort of stuff either. Just talking to different web admins, I do know there is targeted cyber attacks already happening to Māori. Usually whenever there's a Waitangi Tribunal claim in the news or a big payout, web admins I know say that their Māori websites and their servers get hammered quite badly after that. So, and again, it's, well, what do you do? What do, you know, they do nothing. They just, people just talk amongst themselves as opposed to going to the authorities. Another risk at the moment I see is when iwi and Māori organisations get consultants to digitise their genealogy and their membership records. There's some considerations about how you digitise would be important. And so one of them would be if you could have an office where people can't eat or drink, where you're digitising that information, that would help to keep things culturally safe and more than likely help you get the contracts as well. So that brings it to the end of the presentation. So as I said, it was a scattered approach trying to cover all sorts of topics and aspects for everybody. I'm more than happy to take questions and assist people with questions or queries that they might have. So if there's any questions, I've got a couple of minutes, I can answer them now. Or yes.
Yeah, just a quick one. So do you also think that there might be positive values that Māori can bring to the infosec community?
that there are positive values that Māori can bring to the InfoSec community in New Zealand. So at this conference, we've heard talks about drinking culture, about mental health, which indicate to us that maybe not everything is as honky-dory in our community as we think it is. We love to talk about community in InfoSec, and maybe we see much less of it. And I am actually have thought for a couple of times that maybe that is something where Māori could contribute.
Sure. So I think there's a lot that Māori could contribute to, and I think that as we're starting to shift into this area, that people will be able to talk more freely and openly about contributing more positively. This is a new area at the moment, and it's also so diverse as well. There's a group of academics who are working on Indigenous data sovereignty. There's another group looking at ethics and cultural ethics and how to work in partnership with the InfoSec community. I think there's definitely an opportunity and pathway there. So. Mm-hmm. Cool. Awesome. Okay, cool, thank you.